subcommittee meeting to order. 18:03. So we called this meeting because there was a RFP sent out to look for proposed housing for South County EMS. And we got two replies in. One is the Wheatley Municipal Building, the old library building. And the second place that submitted was the old South Deerfield Fire Department and the bank building next door also. That's a combination, right?
Correct.
So, did anything besides that?
We did get a letter from the South Deerfield Fire District, which, technically speaking, isn't a response to the RFP, but it was submitted in response to the RFP, which was read aloud at the opening of the RFP, but I don't know if you would like to read it again, or...
Sure. That's the same thing that was on the website, right? The Deerfield website?
Yes. So both responses to the RFP and this letter have been uploaded to the Town of Deerfield website to comply with 30B GL.
I'll just read the letter from South Deerfield Fire. South Deerfield Fire District would like to respond to the posted RFP for building space for ambulance service housing. Although we are not able to fulfill the requirements specified within the RFP, we would like to extend the present accommodations through FY 18 year if the town was to install a building on town-owned lot located adjacent to the north of our parking lot. We would extend a deeded right of way for access to said property. Also, if the building did not have a large conference room, the district would extend the use of our large room at no charge to South County. Kevin Scarborough, Prevention Committee Chair.
As usually, they continue to support us, so they can't meet the RFP needs.
The package. What else came in?
Yep, there are so many copies of the same thing.
There's a copy up here if somebody wants to peruse it, but I would appreciate it if you'd share, because we only have one copy.
So this is a first for me. I don't know if we should... We've got the RFP, copy of the RFP, which gives us the standards. I've also included a scoring sheet for each standard and a number, and the responses in front of us. I don't know what the best way to go about this is.
Yeah. This is new for most of us. Just wing it.
Wing it.
Wing it. Yeah, let's see. Since we brought up the first one, this is from the town of Wheatley. Is that the first one I saw?
Yep.
And somebody with some glasses can read the categories.
Sure. So in the RFP,
well, probably what we should do is, I mean, you got your scoring sheet. We'll go block by block.
Yeah, so it starts.
We can look up and compare.
Go through it.
Yeah, it starts on page 9 of the RFP, the comparative criteria. First criteria is location of property and access, and the it's ranked in three different options: either non-advantageous, advantageous, or highly advantageous.
There. Did you check to make sure that they meet the minimum?
Oh, yes, right? So there's, thank you.
If you want to do that first, because they're going to be disqualified. If they don't meet the minimum, then that'll keep it nice and simple. It's a good way of eliminating.
Thank you. I do recall, let me see if I have it handy, during the bid opening process, Doug Finn in Deerfield ranked whether they met the minimum requirements.
And they get big sheets and we get this.
We're trying to save the money on copy.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. Here, I don't need these for a little while.
Here you go, buddy. They're 2.5s.
Oh, that's
that might
be dizzy.
So this tally sheet is lists everybody who requested a copy,
yep.
And then the two responses. And Doug did go through and did make sure that in this case, Town of Whately, they did include everything that they were required to include, and anything that wasn't applicable to the Town of Whately is not there. But that they did meet all the requirements, and the other respondent. For the Sugarloaf Street, all did include all necessary items. So they meet the requirements for consideration. Also included was the South Deerfield Fire District letter, which
had all no's.
Right.
Okay.
So there we go.
Thank you.
Keep going without me. I don't know where I put my sheet.
Which one?
Yeah, this one.
Oh,
I got it. All right. Thanks, folks. Appreciate it. All right.
Are we back to the highly advantageous criteria?
Yes. So location of property and access. Highly advantageous would be the premises are located in or near the South Deerfield Village Center and provide existing convenient access to primary roads and will, in the opinion of the town, facilitate an acceptable travel time to 85% of the response areas.
Now there's an addendum on that, right?
Yes, there is. So an addendum issued May 17th for the RFP changed the language just to clarify the original intent. So I'll read from the addendum. The premises are, and it was changed to, centrally located within the EMS service area and provide existing convenient access to the primary roads and will need to make the town facilitate an acceptable travel time to 85% of the response area. So it struck out that located in or near the South Deerfield Village Center and replaced it with centrally located within the EMS service area. Advantageous would be the premises are not centrally located within the EMS service area or provide existing convenient access to the roads or facilitate the acceptable travel time. And not advantageous, the premises are not and will not, in the opinion of the town, facilitate acceptable travel time.
What do we have for a gauge that gives us 85%?
I don't know what we have for a gauge that gives us that 85%, other than when I previously ran the data as far as our call locations, and actually the central point to all of our calls as mapped out as Google points, it actually falls right in the Industrial Park, Sandy Lane area. So I don't have a metric to be able to say travel time specifically, but I do know that it's centrally located to our EMS service area.
Did you bring your computer with you?
I did not.
Sorry. So
I know Baxter's gave us a little bit of that. It's targeted.
If it's hitting in that general area of your central point, then we're in good shape.
Yeah, it's in my opinion that it is centrally located within the EMS area. I guess the question then is, does it provide convenient access to primary roads?
It's pretty close to 116.
It could, very easily, but it doesn't in its present.
It's a work in progress.
It's a work in progress. It's something at this point in time doesn't.
Right.
You don't go to, it's happy we would be being in the industrial park or access through it, but it's really close.
At some point in time, then that may change.
Yes. Well, coming around Pine Street and getting to that central point, there's no more any further or time consuming than it would be from getting from Center Village, the fire station, or anywhere else in that central point. So it's as good as it gets without being actually in the industrial park itself.
Mm-hmm. Have you done any kind of a dry run from that building to 116?
We've had some calls to Sandy Lane, so the reverse of going out, and it's just like any other location sent in our central EMS response district. It's pretty short.
A minute or something.
Yeah, I think the reverse, leaving out on Pine Street and going through that neighborhood and around that corner, I think, you know, in my opinion, that's been one of my concerns with that location. So I don't think it reaches the metric of providing existing convenient access to the, I think that's pretty inconvenient access to 116 from my opinion. So I'm gonna personally grade it accordingly, but mm-hmm. That's just my opinion.
No, I think there's no real argument.
Is this as riveting out there as it is over here?
Can I ask a question, Zach?
Yeah.
If the ambulance does end up going there, would the state or public safety put a light at that intersection?
So there's been discussion of that. South County EMS, I don't want to speak on behalf, but did approach DEDIC and talked about, we have heard that intersection with Industrial Drive was already plumbed for a traffic light and things like that. So there's some existing infrastructure there, and we did discuss that in the interest of public safety, we would like to see something there, whether it's a constant permanent light or not just
a trip.
Yeah, like Northampton Fire has something out on King Street right. That is normally not, it's just a flashing yellow.
You're not talking about Pine Street.
Yeah, that's like, yeah, but that, what about Pine Street?
Oh, Pine Street?
It came out on the Pine.
Oh, I don't know.
Pine Street has not been scoped out or ranked.
Whether the state would do something.
Right.
You know, I mean,
coming out there, I noticed that, you know, the trees are really hard to see as you're pulling up there. And
yeah. Right.
You're coming up over the hill.
Those are things, the trees are something we can deal with.
The
state and the town can work together to deal with that one, but putting a light there for just the ambulance.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for the longest time, tractor-trailer trucks have been using Pine Street to come out.
Right.
And it's not been, with the exception of an electrical wire coming across the pickup truck, has not been that hazardous.
Okay.
I mean, I haven't gone back and researched it, but in my recent memory, I can't remember any accidents.
I've been at Berkshire Gas in their coldest winter months. They have like 3 trucks a day going in and out of there.
Okay.
And that's an average of what our calls are. It's 3 calls a day.
Yeah.
So, okay. And again, we're, you know, it's hard to fathom what we're asking for because it's such a small scope.
Right.
So when you talk about, you know, when you talk about having access to DEDIC, we're talking about 1 or 2 or maybe 3 calls a day because it's only, but the problem is you've got to think about everything else that would take that same path or that same route or if it got more conducive. I hope that people would understand that if it became hazardous, we'd be looking for something else to make it correct. Or either move the facilities, we do whatever it has to do so that basically
people
we don't. Yeah, we're in the safety business. We don't want to be causing the accident. So
right.
Whatever we do, you know, as we do this, is going to be gauged upon how much safety
it
reacts with.
Thank you.
Any other questions or input on this subject?
Just to reiterate that we did ask CEDIC for permission to go through there, but I don't think they were in position because we weren't in the building to grant us any access.
Yep.
And so it might be worth another shot if we were.
Well, the other aspect of it is there's a possibility of a legal requirement because CEDIC is a legal entity.
Yeah.
And we may have to go through legislative
premise.
So there's a lot of unknowns.
Right.
And there's very little that's been able to ferret that out because you're chasing windmills if you're doing it ahead of the game.
That's right.
CEDIC had their attorney take a look at it, and the comments that we got back was based on the legal work that was done to incorporate that industrial park. There needed to be a setback, and that's part of the legal setback that's there, and they were not in a position to begin to explore what it would take to breach that setback.
Yeah.
And again, to Mark's point, we didn't have a firm commitment of where we were going.
Right. You know,
there were questions about, had we done engineering to figure out what the cost of the road might be? One of the members was concerned it might cost us $1 million to put a road through there. Mm-hmm. To which we stated, you know, if it's going to be $1 million, we're certainly not going to put a road through there. But in speaking with highway department supers in the past, the idea was they would go through and gravel it and blacktop it for us. And, you know, the two towns would work together and get it done.
Sure.
We talked about the idea of some type of a gate like the South Deerfield Fire Department has, an access control gate.
Yes.
Or one-way signs, emergency vehicle access only. Mm-hmm. We discussed a number of possibilities, but their sticking point came down to they had legal paperwork and legal documents that said they needed that setback and that we couldn't violate that setback.
Okay.
And apparently somebody had asked in the past and there was a whole regurgitation of what the past history had been and why were we coming to ask again. So I said we didn't know and we came to ask because you don't find out unless you ask the question.
So, in this marking so we're consistent, so are we going to do a 1, 2, 3?
That's what I was just thinking. One highly advantageous.
The top right of your scoring sheet has a scoring key. And it's very small for Mark.
3 is highly advantageous, 2 is advantageous, and 1 is not advantageous.
Are there any points between the 1 and 3? Or 0 and 3? Or is it just a strict 1, 2, or 3?
It's a 1, 2, or 3. So if it meets your whatever
3 is the best.
Whatever definition is, and then, 3 is the best. And some of these conditions are only 2, either advantageous or not advantageous, but the scoring numeric stays the same. Yeah.
Thanks for pointing that out.
No problem. All right.
That could Whately Building go on to the next one, condition of premises?
Yep. So condition of premises. Highly advantageous, the premises and all the structural elements of the building are currently in commercially acceptable move-in condition suitable for town use and the proposed premises are nearly constructed or recently renovated. Advantageous is the premises and all the structural elements of the building are currently in commercially acceptable move-in condition suitable for town use. Not advantageous, the premises and or the structural elements of the building must be improved by the owner to place them in commercially acceptable move-in conditions suitable for town use.
Okay, so we know that it's not set up for EMS use as it sits.
Correct.
But it does have apparatus bays.
Apparatus bays, it is HVAC, it is protected from the elements, there is running water, there is bathrooms.
One story. Any other comments on that from your perspective, Chief?
Well, so let's see. The breakdown is highly advantageous is they're move-in ready, commercially acceptable, and have been recently constructed or renovated. That's highly advantageous. Advantageous is move-in ready, commercially acceptable. And not advantageous is must be improved by the owner to place them in commercially acceptable move-in conditions. To me, I mean, that reads as if there's any sort of renovation that is required, then it would be
advantageous.
Or I was going to say non-advantageous.
I'd say non-advantageous because it's going to need to be built out on the inside before we can move in. It's not like there's offices set up and it's all walled off and ready to go.
I'm perplexed because the reality is the building is the same as what you have at the fire station right now. You have bathrooms, you have union furniture, but all of the walls and everything else are just...
Well, I mean, we have a private room that we can
close. Big private room right
now. Well, it's gigantic, but it's bigger than what the proposal outlines. So, I mean, it requires, in order for it to meet what the proposal is, walls would have to be built. Which to me reads as not advantageous.
I would put it in the middle. I would put it in the middle.
In the middle?
Middle.
In the middle?
You'd score it as a 2 as opposed to a 1.
Yeah.
I'm not the chief, but I'm sure, surely if somebody said, hey, this is your building, I'd be in it tomorrow. If you're back in the they take care of the ambulance, they take care of everything. If I had to put tents up, I'd be there tomorrow because basically it gives you what at least we've heard at this table for the last year and a half is we need everybody under one roof and doing the job. So for me, it's advantageous because you could move in tomorrow. You wouldn't have all the sweet things that you like, but it wouldn't. It would get the job done.
Well, the nice thing about the scoring sheet is we all get to
say our same.
Yep, score the way that we feel is most appropriate, and then we'll total or average at the end. And
any input from anybody else?
Well, the only thing you say you move in tomorrow, but there's no bathroom for you to use.
Sure, there is.
No, there is. Yeah, there is. Not in that lease space.
Yeah.
If you go into somebody else's space, there is.
Well, no, the whole space is open right now. There's a bathrooms in there directly.
It's Kip's point is that the bathroom, if this is the space they're giving us, the bathroom is over here, and it's not technically in the space.
Right. But the space is here.
This is the space
is what we're going to have.
I know. So
that's what I'm talking about. If we negotiate with it, we can put our vehicles there. We can have bathrooms and things we need.
Mm-hmm.
And if we have to do renovations.
Once that wall is up, they're going to have to put in a bathroom.
Exactly.
Right. Well, you would want a shower and everything.
Right, but that's what I'm saying. Sleeping. But if you're reading that the way you were reading it, there is currently no bathrooms, no dividing of walls or anything.
Right.
So,
and there are bathrooms without the walls. You put the walls in there.
But not in your lease space. There's no bathrooms in your lease space.
Okay.
You have access.
Yeah, that's what I'm.
I got that point. I understand what you're saying. And it's just a difference of opinion. So,
it would be a difference of opinion, Mark. There are no bathrooms in that space.
It's not the final product, but it's...
There is usable bathrooms that achieve the space that they would move into.
This is the space that they delineated within this red mark, correct?
Correct.
All right, that's what they offered you. Where are the bathrooms in that area?
Well, I think part of the...
I know what you're saying, but...
I think part of the response addresses sharing of other portions of the building, too, does it not?
Does it?
I didn't get to that point. Like the conference room... there was some language in there regarding something. Thinking back, maybe that was in the proposal that was done last year. That's probably not in the RFP.
Well, and from my understanding, from my conversations with Doug Finn, is that falls within the realm of things that can be
negotiable.
Yes, and adjusted without changing the terms of the RFP. You know, if we're requesting access to those bathrooms for the time being, that is well within what we can legally negotiate.
Their response said this facility includes adequate space. Well, I guess that would be the key word: adequate space for administrative offices, dorm rooms, restrooms, a kitchenette, a day room, secure storage, equipment storage, and three oversized garage bays to accommodate all three ambulances.
Okay. Any other?
All right. Capacity of premises. Highly advantageous. The premises provides suitable and appropriate space for garaging of three Type 1 ambulances plus office and staff space in compliance with the specifications provided in this RFP and otherwise appropriate for 24/7, 365 emergency response service ready for immediate occupancy. Advantageous. Premises provide suitable and appropriate space for garaging of three Type 1 ambulances, plus available space for build-out of office and staff space in compliance with specifications provided. Not advantageous. The premises does not provide suitable and appropriate space for garaging of three Type 1 ambulances or office and staff space in compliance with specifications provided. So to me, that sounds like advantageous. Since there is some build-out that must occur in the office and staff space.
That's a given. Is there any other points?
Is that Type 1, you know, if it's a 1, you can't get in the middle door, but that wouldn't be maybe the Type 1 ambulance?
So the difference between a Type 1 and a Type 3 are negligible. It's okay. Just depending on what type of chassis it's so that is...
The RFP only asked for 10-foot wide doors.
Oh, okay, good.
And we have a 10. We have a 10 and
yeah.
We have 2 20s or whatever.
Yeah.
Actually, you showed all those vehicles are really the same size. It's just the mirrors.
That's right.
The larger, heavier duty truck is a few feet longer, but they all, just even this afternoon, I've parked all the ambulances in the bay and they do fit. So it's, let's see. All right. Number 4.
Wait a minute. Any other comments or questions? I'm going to make sure that everybody gets. Thank you. Sorry.
Number 4.
Parking and garage.
Parking and garage use. Highly advantageous. The premises include ample on-site zoning-compliant parking to allow for use of the space by town officials and the public. Advantageous. The premises include sufficient on-site zoning-compliant parking to allow for use of space by town officials and the public. Not advantageous. The premises do not include sufficient on-site zoning-compliant. So the difference here is ample, sufficient, or does not have sufficient.
Says the parking lot as currently configured consists of 68 regular parking spaces and 3 designated handicap parking spaces.
You said 60?
68 regular and 3 handicap.
And their response says that we're allowed to use those spaces? There's no limits on that?
Doesn't say we can't use them.
Okay.
Right. The parking lot is currently configured, consists of 68 regular parking, 3 designated handicap for a total of 71. The lot is to be shared with all current and future tenants.
Yeah. That sounds like ample.
Minimally.
So yeah, highly advantageous.
Questions?
I guess you won't have enough room to really have a block party down here.
Yeah, right. Well,
right?
Yeah.
Have to use the
cow barn across the street.
Next one is utilities.
Utilities. Advantageous, so there's only two here, either advantageous or non-advantageous. Advantageous is the premises are serviced by electrical and communications facilities of commercial grade. Non-advantageous is the premises are not presently serviced by electrical and communications facilities of commercial grade. So that sounds like advantageous to me.
So that's just a two and a one?
Yep, so that would just either be a two or a one.
Questions from anybody? I'll even put valuable, and even if we disagree, it's very valuable. So,
next one is handicap access.
Yep, handicap access, and there is a addendum number two issued May 17th, 2016. That was to answer a question by somebody that was questioning why does it need to be handicapped accessible if one of the requirements of being an EMT or a paramedic is that you can climb stairs and lift and things of that nature. And the response in the addendum is any space in the facility that may be accessed by the public, entrances and egresses, any common meeting room space, any common walkways, any common hallways must be ADA compliant. So the understanding is that we will have visitors to the department, so if it's public space, then it would need to be ADA compliant. So the handicapped access advantageous, the premises are fully handicapped accessible under federal and state law. Non-advantageous is premises are not handicapped accessible. And I believe in the RFP, Waitley says explicitly that it is fully handicapped accessible in this space.
Would they have to go through the front, probably? Because you got stairs everywhere else, right?
Mm-hmm. With this door on the side, if they could go through, then you could go find that landing.
Oh, you'd be outside?
Yeah. Okay, that's the same for that. Or if you're in the garage area.
I see.
Okay.
And the handicap or public should not be allowed through the garage area.
Right.
Right.
And that's one of the things that they dinged on the other side, because we don't have that accessibility.
Oh, I see.
There. So that's why it rocked it out of being very agitation, because you've got to have that access.
Right.
All right. And then the last metric is availability. And this is only either advantageous or non-advantageous. Advantageous is the premises are immediately available for occupancy. And non-advantageous is the premises are not immediately available for occupancy.
And the response was the space offered for lease is available for immediate occupancy.
For immediate occupancy.
Correct.
All right. So I would call that advantageous.
Sorry, anybody have any comments? Before I mark this?
It's been ready for a long time.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure I don't jump the gun on that. So.
Yeah. In reviewing the plans, I know I'd be remiss if I didn't at least mention this, that in the blueprints or the schematic that was provided by Waitley, they are counting some office space. It says 220 square feet and an entry into what is now the loading dock in the garage. We went by today just to measure and confirm. Our ambulances do fit in the garage space as it sits now. Operationally looking forward, it had always been my goal to actually remove that dock and give the crews room to take the stretcher out and clean the back of the ambulance inside the conditioned space. It'd be protected from the elements for that. So this plan provided by Waitley is incorporating that dock space for office space. Otherwise, you know, there's still looks like 1,300 square feet, either 1,300 or 1,200 square feet inside the larger area that has been blocked off, and I don't know if they're considering a front door to our agency to be the one into the garage, or whether there's also a new internal one where it says secure door. I'm not sure what they have envisioned, but that would be something that I would want to discuss or talk about at some point.
Well, the other way of addressing the issue of having the space for downloading your gurney and so forth from the ambulance is to go out the front of the garage area. The dock is 11 feet, so even if you went out 11 or 12 feet, that would give you 40 feet inside the garage up to the dock. And I think the cost of taking that loading dock out, breaking it up and re-cementing and making sure the wall between the office space and the garage has a full wall, may be cost effective just to add on the shed roof to the front and make that all garage too.
Well, yeah, and I'm not an engineer. You know, I've heard that that loading dock is not integral to the structure of the building, and so it was feasible that it could be removed. I don't know about cost. I don't know, whatever the solution would be, as from an operational standpoint for long-term occupancy, I would need, if the standard is 40 feet to be able to service and work on an ambulance and be able to open all the compartments and clean it and do stuff like that.
Well, there's an option anyway.
Yeah, sure.
Would that be something South County EMS has to pay for, or is that something Waverly's willing to pay for?
Well, that's
I think any improvements.
Anything can work. Yeah, if we have to have it, speaking from South County aspect of it, if it's something that we want, unless we're put in the RFP that has to be that big, it's what we want and we're going to end up paying for it. Okay. So that's why it's important to ferret these out first, because basically if it's a necessity, we want to make sure that it's captured in the cost. And we know how fast things get done, so let's worry about the important things that actually have to get done. So, any other questions or comments or concerns about the lady proposal?
John, at one point when we looked at plans, there was talk of another driveway out to Long Plain Road. Is that something that's still being considered, or was that scrubbed?
I don't know where that stands. The last plan that I kind of drew up did have that in there, and actually changed your public entrance over to where it says existing door. Feasibility wise, I think there's a couple of things, like you mentioned, setback with Dedek. There's a setback requirement for a driveway off any adjacent parcel of land, and that would, I think, impinge on that. So you got to go through some permitting process also. The other thing to think about is if you don't get the pass-through between the two parks, it's not going to make much difference. You know, the original intent was to perhaps give a straight shot. If you drove out the ambulance bays, turn right, go straight out to Long Plain Road instead of, you know, through the parking lot.
Right.
So I think that would still be on the table. Pretty easy to do.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of that emphasis on that was to be able to get through and not go to Long Plain Road, but to actually go to the Dedek sites and be able, because you don't go to Long Plain if you're going to Dedek at all, to the Dedek site. So, again, it's work in progress.
Yeah. And to be mindful of visitors to the Waitley Municipal Building, and if there's anybody else in that building that, you know, 1,000 times a year, there's going to be an ambulance on its way to an emergency. And 1,000 times a year, there's going to be an ambulance on its way returning from an emergency, traveling through that parking lot. So
it's not a big deal to travel through it, because no matter where we go, we're going to be traveling where people exist. But it's just a cleaner shot if we can do something less dangerous or less, more safety minded. So, and that was the reason for the comments or concerns.
So we got another packet here for the old fire station?
Yes. Take one, pass it down. So this is, the property in question is number 3 and number 7 Sugarloaf Street in South Deerfield. Anybody who's been around for a while will recognize that as the former Bank of America building, now the Deerfield Arts Bank. And long before that, the former South Deerfield Fire Department, now the Schoen Books dealer. So those two properties are owned by the same people, and they have included both of those properties in their response. So that is what we're looking at here. And if you'll excuse me, I'm just going to quickly read over this just to refamiliarize myself with it.
Six,
instance.
Location of property.
Yeah, so starting over with the Sugarloaf Street. Location of property. Again, highly advantageous, advantageous, or not advantageous. And this was the amendment. So it's highly advantageous, is located, essentially located in the EMS service area and provides existing convenient access to primary roads and well in the opinion of the town facility, blah, blah, blah. Advantageous is not in the centrally located area or does not provide existing convenient access to primary roads. Non-advantageous, the premises are not centrally located and do not provide convenient access. Well, I think it's certainly either advantageous or highly advantageous. Sugarloaf Street is wide and gives us easy access to Sunderland, and easy access to South Deerfield and then up onto 5 and 10 for Yankee Candle or up North Main Street. And it was a fire department and picked for its location initially, I would imagine, partially. So the question is, you know, is it too centrally located within, you know, near the four-way stop? I think that would be the only thing that would rub it from highly advantageous to advantageous.
My thoughts, why did South Deerfield Fire District move out of that area?
They didn't have a big enough space. That's one thing you'd be careful of, is basically they had to notch out and get the floor joists to get their equipment in there. So the problem may be the height of our equipment getting into the bays, but because it was a rescue vehicle that actually had them sawing out floor joists. So that was the reason they left. And basically they saw the opportunity because of the, well, I'm gonna be on camera for this, for the fact that they were very highly popular because of the ambulance service making so many runs out of that facility that basically they were able to construct a new building. And it's an aged building. I don't know anything about whether anything other than the cutting of the ceiling and joists have done any, but the structure seems to be sound in that aspect. The other negative may be the fact that right now we can get great access to the north part of Deerfield because of North Main Street. But some of our equipment pretty soon won't be able to go over the drawbridge, and the drawbridge may not be fixed. So we have to go around to get up there, and I think that if you're going up and around through the center of town through the lights, you're going to be at the same, about the same amount of time it would take us to get, if we could get through the park to get to that same location in North. So you're backtracking a lot to get out to a population, and basically there's a lot of school kids that are up in that general area. The one thing good is it's close to Greenville, so that we can get mutual aid in there. But
the drug, which is one of my concerns, and the fact that you're going to have to be driving around it. But I don't think it's, I agree with the chief,
It's not a terrible spot.
It's not a terrible spot.
I think access is easier when you're on 5 and 10 or around that 116 corridor or by, you know, rural pool. It's easier to get around with an emergency vehicle instead of driving to a thickly populated area.
I can't disagree with that. And it's a lot of the fire departments have moved away from the center of town for that simple reason. It's you're endangering other lives when you go out through that area. So
the only benefit is it does have the traffic control signals in place. So while you have heavier traffic, when you get out to 116 or 5 and 10, you've got lights that'll stop traffic to let you out. It's going to be getting through the center of town.
The center of town. The dysfunction junction in the center of town where it's not square, crossroads are going to be. That's why I said, as long as you can go up 5 and 10, go up North Main Street and not have to do that dipsy-doo in the middle of it, I think that it's going to be fine. But keep in mind, we've been downgraded once already this year. And they're back out there looking at it again to see if that driver is going to support. And nobody is in the mood for having a race through that section of town. So it's one of those things where it's going to be the biggest fight you ever saw, trying to keep that in place. So,
all right.
Any questions, concerns?
Isn't just the biggest difference between those advantageous or highly advantageous is the location of the building?
Correct.
I mean, this really doesn't address the difference of, it doesn't, you don't get a chance to grade the access or not.
Yeah, so the difference is, highly advantageous is it's centrally located and provides existing community access. Advantageous is it's lacking one or the other. And then non-advantageous is it doesn't have either. The condition being centrally located and ease of access.
Says it's not located centrally. So doesn't that kind of throw that out?
It's not centrally located.
It is centrally located, but I'm saying the advantageous says that the premises are not centrally located.
That's
what it says here.
So you're saying it is centrally located, so it has to be.
I see what you're saying, Gary.
I was reading it the other way.
They're only giving you one choice.
Yeah,
it
doesn't really address the access or, you know, if it's.
I don't want to say the wrong word here. The spirit of these is that there's two metrics, centrally located and ease of access to primary roads. So highly advantageous has both of those. Non-advantageous has none of them, and just advantageous has just one of those two things.
It has one or the other, not one.
Yeah,
right.
Okay,
so think about the primary road for, I guess, convenient access.
Right, but the location is pretty much a cut and dry thing. I mean, it throws it out. I mean, it doesn't really say it's located centrally, but the access may be an issue. I mean, I don't know how to say that really, but, you know.
I think the location meets the requirement of being centrally located. The access point, it's a wash either way. Either we're coming out of Pine Street and you're waiting at 116, or you're going through the center of South Deerfield and you got stop signs to deal with. I think, you know, my personal opinion.
Anybody else?
All right, number two, condition of premises. Highly advantageous. All the structural elements, commercially acceptable moving condition, suitable for use. And the premises are newly constructed or recently renovated. Advantageous is all the structural elements, commercially acceptable, with move-in condition and suitable for use. So the difference being whether or not it was recently constructed or renovated. And then non-advantageous is the premises or the structural elements of the building must be improved by the owner to place them in commercially acceptable move-in conditions suitable for town use. The description of the location is that it has kitchen facility, it has sleeping facility, it has office space, and that the respondent says it's in its condition and move-in ready. That they've both run a business and lived in that. And that is ostensibly what a 24/7 emergency services department does, conducts a business and lives there. So it would seem to me that it is in a move-in condition, but has not been recently constructed or renovated.
Well, it's not ADA compliant.
I think we'll... that'll be number six. I think we'll have that discussion for handicapped access.
Did you go measure the bays, or did you look at the bays for having your accessibility around the apparatus?
That's going to be...
That was one of the issues the fire department had.
I did measure it, and there's some more information in the thing. Do we want to talk about that under parking and garage use, or...
Sure. That makes sense. I just thought about that being part of move-in ready being the fact that you can't get out of the vehicles or you don't have that same space you're looking for.
If that's what you're worried about, from my measurements, it's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Concern I have is the age.
Sure.
That's not addressed here anymore. You got a 70-year-old building, 75-year-old building, whatever it is. It doesn't tell you how new the furnace is, the heating system, the wiring, any of that. It does say there's no sprinkler system, no fire alarms or any of that stuff. So it's not move-in ready.
Sure.
All right. The way I see it.
Well, it's built between 37 and 39, so you're talking
75, 80 years.
80 plus years.
Yeah. So.
I'm sorry, 79 to 77 to 79 years old, depending on.
Yeah. And they tell you that it's been renovated, you know, the apartment's been built in the 90s, I guess, something like that. But it tells you how it's heated, but, you know, it's at a 50-year-old furnace or 75-year-old furnace, or, you know, the wiring, has it been updated? It doesn't say any of that.
I want to say, from my remembrance, we'd have to go back and check. I thought the furnace was replaced either shortly before South Deerfield fire moved out or right around that time, because I believe there was an issue with it and they were looking to make that change.
And when was that?
You'd have to ask. About 1990, so if it hasn't been updated since, it could be 27 years old.
Yeah, and it was installed for the electrician at the time.
Could I ask, has anybody gone to look at that space recently?
No, I have not. I haven't been there 20-something years, so.
There was a invitation and walkthrough like months ago.
It may have been last summer or last fall that we went over there and walked through it to take a look.
When this whole discussion started coming up, the people approached and said, you know, is this something you might be interested in, and invited some people in.
I don't know if as you're considering, any of you thought like to go there and see what was there, you know?
Yeah.
If there were any items that you guys were talking about that looked, you know, bad or bad.
Well, I know, I mean, site visits and things like that are certainly well within the purview of this,
I mean,
this committee.
I feel comfortable that the things like the furnace going is an anticipated thought process. But in this case, we get two of them that you'd have to worry about. And the bank left the building for a specific reason, but we're not going to know what they are. The last time I was in the basement of the bank, it was damp, but that can be fixed. I mean, I think that no matter where we go, we're going to have to do something.
Well, the other issue...
And how much that something's going to cost is going to be a variable litany of getting from here to there. So we're talking... Sometimes we're getting into the nitty-gritty, but for the most part, I think we're looking at the general scope of... Does it fit our needs?
Well, the other issue you have is you're talking buying versus leasing. So well, the furnace goes when you're
that
leasing.
That comes after we get done with this. Yeah. I'd rather not get into the discussions of all that until we get done scoring them and then...
Well, that's where I have a problem with scoring. Because
well, we don't have to accept, when we get done with the process of this, the conversation then goes to, okay, they're scored, and this is where they score. If we have issues that are, well, that's true.
Yeah. God. This is a first for me, so don't yeah. turn to me for anything.
Doug, and if you could lend some guidance here, my understanding is to go through, the scores are assigned based on the criteria in the RFP. We can then have discussion about what we'd like to do, and at the end of that discussion, either we can accept one of the properties, or we can throw the whole thing out. So
we can accept one, accept the other, reject all of them.
And the thing is, the scoring process is right now just getting factual things on the table. They're not, from my point of view, they never override the final discussion of the wants and don't wants. Yeah. We're scoring it based upon a thought process, and if we have to, please jump in.
Well, that's where my point is I don't know, you know, this scoring process that you came up with doesn't address these issues.
I did do some asking about a purchase, and my understanding, Doug, you can correct me if I don't mean to put you on the hot seat. I mean, essentially, the town of Deerfield would have to do the purchase and then transfer the cost over to the enterprise fund if it was the properties what we're currently looking at.
So at that point in time, all you can do is make a recommendation because we can't buy it.
Right. Right.
I looked at that scoring system as well, and my concern is that I would hope that in both cases that your board gets a fairly accurate estimate of what the build out or repairs in any facility would be prior to making a decision. Mm-hmm. You know, don't just use that because there is a lot, like Gary said, there's a lot of vagueness out there. You know,
I'd like to add that the RFP, as you adjudicate the responses, you have to use the criteria as your primary judgment on these responses. The criteria are sufficiently vague, I think, that you can say, for example, as you did in relation to location, centrally located and convenient access to a major artery. You talked about stop signs at the end of Elm Street or at the four-way stop in the center of South Deerfield. You talked about the condition of the dry bridge. You talked about easy access to Waverly, Sunderland, and so on and so forth. I wasn't here, but I'm sure you talked about the stop sign at the end of Pine Street when you're talking about the Waverly facility. Those, strictly speaking, don't have to do, they're not regarding whether or not the place is centrally located or has access to a major artery, but they do relate in a broad sense to that. The criteria you're assessing is its location. What details of that criteria you include under that umbrella is up to you. Does that make sense? So you're talking about the move-in condition of the building, and you're talking about its wiring condition, does it need upgrades, will we need to invest money in it, what's the condition of the roof, all that. All of that does come under, is it ready to move in?
Right, so we didn't specify that we needed offices to be built out, carpeting on the floor, VCT tile in the kitchen and hallways. We didn't specify that the building, if it was within a quarter mile of a main thoroughfare being 116 or 5 and 10, and that intersection is controlled by a traffic device that we were able to put a light on top and hit a button, and so we didn't get that detailed.
But I don't think we have to. I think that
no,
what
we don't.
Gary's pointing out is the fact that we're, and again, my understanding, and I misread it, I guess, is the fact that this was going to give us something that was either going to have us a place that we could move into, or somebody was going to fix it up and rent it to us to move into, in other words, give us a proposal. The fact that we can't buy something, how do we have the discussion, or how do we make a proposal to somebody that really just starts another ball rolling? Because the building has to be bought by somebody, by the town of Deerfield.
It has to be bought by the fiscal agent, sure.
It has to be bought by the town of Deerfield. That's not going to happen until another town meeting and another fiscal aspect of it. We're not.
No change of location is going to happen until another town meeting.
Yeah, but this is going to be two or three if we build a building and then have to go through the process of being. You're not going to get by with one town meeting discussing where the thing is going to be.
I think this will be the first step. We got to
go through
scoring.
Yeah, keep going.
And then phase two, we're going to have to say, well, okay, this one scores good for X, Y, and Z. Yeah. Capacity of premise?
Capacity of premises. Highly advantageous. Suitable and appropriate space for garaging of 3 Type 1 ambulances, plus office and staff space, in compliance with the specifications.
Do we know that?
Do we know?
Fit your new ambulance, or
that it's suitable for
A1
in there?
So the garage bays, each of them are 11 feet wide and 10 feet tall, and I guess they were widened at some point I actually ran into one of the individuals, and they said that the facade was cut back and removed to widen the doors. So I measured it at 11 feet and 10 feet high, which accommodates all of our ambulances. She also says in the response
that it will fit 4 ambulances in there.
Yeah, well, and that the ceiling height in the front is around 12 to 14 feet, and then it begins to taper off in the very back of the garage. It's 8 feet tall.
It doesn't say how deep that is. So.
It's 79 something feet, I think. It's in the blueprint, but I don't know. I don't know. Right at what point it starts to taper off.
But the RFP says that the doors have to be 12 feet tall. If this doesn't meet that, then...
Nice catch, Gary.
So the total length of the building is 75 feet, 4 inches.
And it looks like the doors are 11.9 high, right? Are you reading that?
Yeah, but like I said, you said they have to be 12.
Where does it, I'm not questioning you, but where does it say that?
I'm not questioning it.
Yeah, there it is. I see it. First page. East bay must be directly accessible to the outside through a 10-foot wide garage door, at least 12 feet in height. Our tallest ambulance is 9.5 feet tall.
Still doesn't matter.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying, as far as perspective goes.
I think that if this is the final caveat, that's one of the things that needs to be on the punch list. Because I think that the floor and the ceiling both shrink to the back. And when you get to the back probably 12 to 15 feet, you had a hard time getting a pickup truck back there.
So I guess this is a procedural thing. The metric for capacity and premises is suitable and appropriate space for garaging 3 Type 1 ambulances. If the garage door is 11 feet tall, but I think that's not going to have an effect on me garaging 3 Type 1 ambulances, does it matter that the beginning of the RFP requests, is that, I mean, is it just like, they, like, because
I don't have to answer that, but it doesn't meet your requirements. You're asking for something, yeah, the ambulance will fit, but you didn't ask for that.
Well, is it a require? I mean, it's, I guess.
What does the first part of the RFP say? Does it give specific dimensions?
Yes.
It probably must be
in a 10 feet wide by at least 12 feet tall.
Okay.
That's what it says.
How long are the ambulances?
Zach said earlier you need 40 feet.
Well, our longest 40. Ambulance is 25 feet long.
No, they need 40 feet for...
You get the vehicle length to be able to service the front and to access the back and fully offload a stretcher.
Right. But
36, 38 feet.
Also you need 80 feet.
You need 80 feet supposedly, but the same token, you can pull an ambulance back after you've serviced it. And then
yeah, but
you're 40 feet to service.
But with two of the bays in the library building, or excuse me, in the Whately Municipal Office building, are only, what are they, 30 feet?
26.
29.
Right, so it's, you know, so we can park, we can fit an ambulance.
You can fit them in there and do it. The concern I have is the fact that if you can't get it back far enough, height-wise, and, you know, that...
So the paragraph, the garage bay paragraph sentence in question says, each bay must be directly accessible to the outside through a 10-foot wide garage door at least 12 feet in height.
There you go. Each garage bay must be directly accessible to the outside. Three doors, three ambulances.
Yeah, there's only two doors.
Right?
I would say that that's the intention of it.
Yeah.
That you are able to pull out any vehicle at any time, that you don't have to pull out one vehicle in order to get another vehicle out.
In case one vehicle doesn't start, you want to have the other one.
Exactly. If your primary vehicle doesn't start, you have to do a backup.
That will feel safe, nothing.
You're exactly right.
Yeah. And the government went one step further and told you to put chains on them so you could pull them out of the way. You had to get the chains off before you move the damn vehicles.
You want to beat that section around anymore, or go to parking and garage?
Let's just make sure. Any other concerns or questions? These are great, by the way, guys. The one thing I have is we talked about 10 feet. And this is 11 feet.
Yeah.
This ambulance when you back in, there is no. Back.
Yeah.
You're driving and you're up again.
Sure.
So
yep.
Your 10-foot vehicle is sitting in a 12-foot area. So opening doors could be fun, especially with
great.
The post in the middle of it.
Excellent point. So Mark was pointing out on the blueprint that the width of the bay all the way down is equivalent to the width of the door.
One of the bays. So one of the bays is basically 11.5. And the other one's wider because it has a setback against the building. So it's got some space that the passenger could get out backing it in. And depending on where things end up, you've got a post that's sitting in the middle of the two bays that may stop you from getting to cabinets or things of that nature.
Oh, okay. Whew.
And I don't think those are things that are fixable because you can't make the building any wider and you can't take the posts out, the structural posts out.
Parking and garage use. Premises include ample on-site zoning compliant parking to allow for the use of space by town officials and public. Advantageous, sufficient on-site zoning compliant parking. Non-advantageous, does not include sufficient on-site zoning compliant. How many, they said they have 10 parking spaces between the two buildings?
Currently, CISA next door at 1 Sugarloaf Street is using 4 of those spaces.
I think it's an addition to
5, 6. Yeah, I think they're using spaces that essentially are that exit off onto is it Grave Street?
Grave Street.
The back exit.
Yeah, I think they gave you a total.
Yeah,
they did.
This.
I know. I read it, but I think that were, it wasn't that they took away, those were additional ones.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 total plus, there's 10 here, plus the handicap.
10 plus the handicap?
5, 4, 5, 4, and 1,
a total of 10.
So, CESA's using 4 of the ones that exist, so you have 3.
6.
6. How many do you need?
4. If we have full staffing during the day.
But that's with no visitors.
That's no, that's no visitors, but I, so if everybody, if nobody cards pool, we would need 4 during the day.
Didn't this specify that you need, you could have 5 people working?
Okay, is that, yeah, that's it. Gary, thank you for keeping me honest. What does the RFP say?
I remember seeing 5 people. Could be working at one time.
Okay.
You know, the other question becomes with CESA, are they just leasing it from the current occupants? And if we moved in, we could terminate that lease? And
I think CESA's going to be going away.
Okay.
But that's not...
Either way, as long as they don't own the property and the property is deeded over to us, then we could end that or terminate that agreement.
You're talking about parking?
Yes.
The parking is simply a handshake agreement. There's no lease or deed or anything like that.
Thank you.
So does it include ample on site?
I think so. I think it's ample on site.
What do you say, 10 spaces?
Yeah. Utilities, either advantageous or not. The premises are serviced by electrical and communications facilities of commercial grade. Not advantageous, but premises are not commercial grade.
Was there any note about the electrical service there?
Doesn't say anything in there.
Now, backing up to that parking, how about the zoning compliant parking? Is that?
It's got enough. Yeah.
I think
it was a bank, so it's got. Yeah, it'd be zoning compliant with handicapped.
And that hasn't changed within the town at all? It's only changes or anything? Okay.
So as far as the utilities go, I'm not an expert, but if it was a bank and a commercial property and it was a fire department...
It had electricity.
Had electricity, and do we have any reason to believe it wouldn't be sufficient for what we would need to run an EMS agency? I don't know.
I mean, like,
how many Xboxes are we running?
That would be step 2 of the process, I guess.
Cable and stuff has come a long way since 25 years ago or whatever.
Sure. Yeah. Well, I think they mentioned they just got cable to the bank building. Is that what I think?
Yeah, they get an internet service to the bank building.
Yeah.
They didn't want to get hacked.
All right.
Next one is handicapped access.
The premises are fully handicapped accessible under federal and state law. Not advantageous. The premises are not handicapped accessible. So here's a good question. If the addendum was common spaces open to the public need to be handicapped accessible, there is that bank building that is handicapped accessible.
Except.
For the bathroom.
It says the bathroom's in the cellar.
Sure.
Right. So it's not handicapped accessible, right? It's because you'd have to take and renovate and put a bathroom on the first floor.
Okay.
To right. make it handicap accessible.
For who? A bathroom for who?
For public.
Public.
Do you public. Need to provide a bathroom for the public?
That's what your addendum says.
Does it say that?
Yeah. I would assume ADA would require in a building.
Well, do you, I mean, the question is, do you have to provide a bathroom to the public, period?
That's my question. Is there a legal or other expectation to provide a bathroom to the public in any building simply because it is open to the public?
Yes.
Yes? You must provide a public bathroom in a real estate office?
Yes.
You must provide a public bathroom in a hardware store?
Yes.
Go tell that to leaders. Last time I had to pee, they wouldn't let me.
That's what the building code says.
You can come to Cole's Building Supply, we'll take care of you.
Thanks, I appreciate that.
Doug, the thing is that grandfather buildings don't have to comply with that.
Okay.
But the minute you start to put any of that commercial space in place, you have to do that.
So if you're talking about, again, the bank building, that's a space that's served as a commercial space since its construction.
But it's a change of use. It's not a bank anymore.
It's been an art gallery. They didn't have to provide public restrooms.
If you want to get really crazy and technical, the building code says that you have to have an ADA compliant bathroom, but it doesn't say that you have to allow people to use it. So go figure.
I would think once you make it a public building, you'd have to provide it in case you have a meeting or something.
I don't know how they got away with it.
You see a lot of stores or something walk into it, they say no public restroom,
right.
But it's a public building. You know, I mean,
right.
You know, you see that all the
don't
time.
Don't start getting sour on me. Come on, Tom. Don't go down that road, please.
Does the addendum specifically state that handicap accessible bathrooms?
Gary?
He just read it. Yes, it does. According to what he
it
read.
It does.
There you are. Yeah.
Any space in the facility that may be accessed by the public, entrances, egresses, common meeting room, any common walkways, any common hallways, must be ADA compliant.
Yeah, but I mean, I think that the argument would be, well, the only common areas accessible to the public are our first floor meeting area, which is our, you know, whatever, and that the basement is not accessible to the public, so therefore we don't need to make it ADA compliant.
Well, you do, because the meeting room is accessible and there's no bathrooms.
But do you have to provide a bathroom? I mean, that's right.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe Kip knows that.
You know, if it's open to the public, it's supposed to be handicap accessible. If you're building, even a new building, and it's a situation where it's not open to the public, say you, I don't know, you made car parts, then it doesn't have to be compliant with handicap accessible. You know, it's only when you invite the public in.
And I think there's a differentiation between public buildings and private buildings. Right. Any public building open to the public area, I think, has got to be, got to have a bathroom.
By public, you mean municipality or?
Yeah, any town. And once you buy that building, it's going to have to be covered, I would think.
And once your grandfather did with the public town hall.
When you're asked a question.
Well, there's some exemption, but I don't think not for ADA.
All I know is that when we did the libraries and we did anything else, as soon as we cracked open over a certain number, you automatically had to put ADA compliant bathrooms.
If the work area is more than 50%, you bring the whole building up to code.
Up to code.
That's right. Yeah.
So that's the reason we don't have to do it in a lot of places, because nobody does that. I mean, in certain states, if you do over $20,000, it has to be ADA compliant, which adds $20,000 to the job, so it usually doesn't get
done. Well, there's another part of the code that says if it's more than 30% of the assessed value of the building, it kicks that in also. So assuming the assessed value is probably fairly low compared to the 650 per year.
It's two separate buildings. Means that if you're modifying the bank, the assessed value is about $300,000. If you're doing more than $150,000 worth of work, the whole building has to come up to code. Entrances, exits, everything.
And as far as the garages, one thing to think about there perhaps is, do you need some kind of ejection system for the fumes inside the garage? What would that add to power requirements and so forth?
Well, these are things that are not in this.
Well, right.
Grading system, you know.
But like you guys said, it's step number one that you have to mm-hmm. go through before you can do number two, I guess. I
mean, yeah, that's my concern is, you know, I mean, because it's not specific enough, you could go through and you could probably come up with a high grade where, you know, it could outweigh another option, but it really isn't worth it because, you know, you got to put all this money into it. But it could give you a high grade.
Even with what you're talking about, 9 criteria or whatever, Aren't we also talking about if one of those fails dramatically? I mean, I don't know much about them. Shouldn't it be dropped if one doesn't meet one of the criterias? Well, if you don't have three bays with 11-foot openings and 12-foot doors on three bays for three ambulances, I'm just asking, why do you go on any further if there's only one door in the front and one door in the back?
No,
I'm just asking.
Yeah, it's a good question.
I would only say because the grading metric provides you for, like, does not meet that requirement. It doesn't, yeah.
It doesn't kick you out at that point in time. But it can be, for us, it can be the reason to reject all, you know, and start over again. If we've got that much black hole, and I think we have the right to go visit the buildings to...
You have the right to go visit the buildings to get further information in order to assess it using the criteria that's in the RFQ.
Correct.
So you have the right to use as much detail in determining any given criteria in the RFP. And if you have to go and tour the building, do measurements, look up code regulations, talk to building inspectors to get some of the answers, that's within your purview and your right. In order for this RFP to be satisfied, you have to use the criteria that's in there. To grade.
Who thought this was a good idea?
He's not here tonight.
My quick Google foo, searching Massachusetts general laws, there is a law that says customers at a retail establishment with a qualifying medical condition must be allowed access to an employee-only restroom. But it says customers and retail establishment.
So next time you're in Leader Town, you have a medical condition, they will let you use the restroom.
Yeah, there you go.
We have a his and hers for this little bit of a moment.
What are you going to do with the... never mind. We're on TV again.
Oh, okay, all right. Well, okay, we beat that. We got one category left, right?
Yep.
Availability. The premises are immediately available for occupancy, or the premises are not immediately available for occupancy. And I believe the respondent January 17, 2017. Yeah.
So they are not immediately available.
Not immediately available. All right. So, what's next?
Well, I think that if there's some topics that arrive that we did not contemplate in this discussion, i.e. Gary's lease versus buying stuff, if there's strong feelings or something, we really probably should get them on the table. How do you guys feel about it?
That the Wheatley deal is the best deal going. That's how I feel.
You're not prejudiced at all. It's okay.
You asked a question. Thank you.
Well,
very much.
No, I was asked about Gary's. You weren't listening.
Oh,
I asked about Gary's concerned about leases versus buying. So.
I'm just concerned about buying an 80-year-old building and what kind of expenses you're going to be running into. Like John says, you know, certain amount of renovations, now you have to bring everything up to compliance. And that could get really expensive on an old building.
Yeah,
plus you own it.
Stupid expensive, yeah.
Yes. I saw that movie.
Plus you own it. So all the future maintenance is on your shoulders, mm-hmm. You know, it's, and what do you do if you decide 3 or 5 years down the road that you're growing and you got to do something else and now you're stuck with a building? What do you do? I don't see a lot of room for expansion there. I don't know how much land was there, I forget. I did look at it, but
there isn't a whole lot on the property for the fire station. It's basically pretty well built out.
It's sitting on what it's got.
Yeah.
It's supported on.
I mean, you've got the bank building next door, but you've got the parking in between.
The fire department moved out because they were outgrown.
Yeah, they were landlocked.
Right.
You needed more bays for more apparatus space. I don't think it fit on site.
I just feel that, you know, you're stuck. You're locked in. You lease something, you're stuck for 3 years. Or whatever your lease agreement's for.
May I ask a question? Sure. As you went through the criteria, did you actually write down numeric scores, all of you?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Did you come up with a total for each of the two?
No.
You didn't?
No. I mean, I've got my individual one. I was going to tally up.
I got mine together.
Because if you can do that and come up with a numerical score where there's an obvious advantage, then all you have to do is determine which of the two, whichever one is higher, determine whether or not you want to continue to pursue that. Right? And if you've got two scores that are really close, then you keep talking. You've got one that's super high and the other super low.
I just wanted to hear things before it became prejudiced by the numbers. I wanted to hear the opinion before it became prejudiced by the numbers.
I guess I get that.
Besides, in my case, it was so close for me that I needed to hear more information.
Fair enough.
To actually make a decision, I needed more discussion. So I don't know how the other group is, although one quiet member tipped his hand. This has been the most people that showed up to help us with this process and the whole arrangement. That includes even when the hate mail was coming, we didn't have that many people show up to discuss it. So thank you very much because you added a lot of good information and made sure that we found out things very effectively. So thank you.
All right, so the totals, I haven't averaged them. Total or average? What do we want?
Total.
Total. So, the maximum score range for each was 28 to 72. I can do some math for you. But the total for the Western Mass Library Building was 61 points. And for the Arts Bank and Schoen Books is 46 points.
Is that including Mark's?
Yes.
That's including mine.
Yep, that's every. That's the four members of the committee.
Why did you single me out?
Yeah.
What did I do?
You said you needed more information.
Oh, no, that yeah. Thank you for that. I just wondered why.
11 and a half versus
15. Ooh, okay.
Average.
Yeah. Oh, they helped you. You got an arcade count. I mean.
And so it was 7 to 18 was the score range, so 11 and a half.
That's what it
was. Yeah, 11 and a half was the average score for the old South Deerfield Fire Station and the bank building, and 15.25 was the average score for the Whaley building. That's taking the totals, dividing it by four. There were four evaluators where we came up with the numbers.
Any questions or concerns before we start figuring out where we go from here?
The only thing I would suggest is you now still have an opportunity to go back and look at the criteria. It seems as though the Whaley building has an advantage. If you decide you're going to focus on that, you can go back, look at the criteria, and get really specific as to whether or not the Whaley building does actually meet all of the operational needs as defined in the RFP. If it meets all the necessities that were defined there, or the necessities that you feel that the ambulance service is going to need.
Right.
If you feel it does, and it's at 80 or 85% there, and maybe there's a little bit of negotiation you need to do, you can still make that recommendation. The negotiation can happen in the signing of a lease. But if you feel confident that that's the best option and you want to proceed forward, you can simply recommend it as it is, knowing you've got that little bit of wiggle room later on down the line.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So if I understand your summation, to be summarized a little bit better, if we're sitting on the fence, we can take a little bit more time to get more detail as to what it is. Mm-hmm. If we're pretty sure that it's going to fit the needs of what we've got, mm-hmm. and all it is to wiggle room around the process,
right.
not going outside of what the criteria was for the RFP, mm-hmm. then we can make that recommendation now. Mm-hmm. Or make our observation to make the recommendation to the Board of Selectmen mm-hmm. at this point in time.
Mm-hmm. Do you make it to the Board of Selectmen, or you make it to the Board of Oversight meeting?
Board of Oversight meeting.
Okay. First. And then the Board of Oversight will take it up.
Yeah, because they will, they may have an issue that they want resolved before we make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen. Okay. So it would have to go to the full board before. Thank you for that. Was an assumption.
I just wanted to be sure.
Yeah.
Oh, that's, yeah, I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah, because
hey, this is the building subcommittee.
Surprise!
It's like four of the six members of the Board of Oversight.
So there's three people dismissed.
Yeah. In reality, this was a subcommittee meeting that we could have just had, but we really appreciate it.
I was not on the subcommittee, so I didn't score. I just offered comment and
discussion. As you guys discussion. Did, it's just three, four. Just four. So.
Well, Zach is on the subcommittee. Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, so. And we could have had others if they had people stand up with their hand raised. We would have taken more people. But, I think we'll ask our chair to have the meeting as soon as possible. We'll discuss our meeting and our findings and discussion with them.
What was the snafu with the Deerfield Selectmen's meeting coming up?
They've got the 15th.
Kind of said you wanted to have our meeting sooner than a normal third Thursday.
Only that lots of folks were talking about wanting to see this happen as quickly as possible, to make a decision as quickly as possible, to move forward as quickly as possible. And the regular Board of Oversight meeting on the 16th was one day after the Select Board meeting. That being said, there's likely going to be a Select Board meeting on the 22nd. I'm not sure if that's true. The one after that will be the 28th. So it's up to you guys to set the clock as you see fit.
You want to change the third Thursday and have it on a Tuesday or something?
I'm going to be out of town. I leave Sunday. I don't get back until late Wednesday night. So I can make Thursday the 16th at this point. I can't make any earlier that week.
We would just stick with the third Thursday.
We'll go for the next meeting. I really think that it's pertinent that because it's going to be on TV and people get a chance to hear what we said and get comments and complaints about it. So I would love to have people come forward and give them enough time to actually respond.
Right.
And
the next they can come to our meeting too.
Yep, and they can come to our meeting too. So that gives, I think, all of the Board of Selectmen a time to have a meeting before. So if there's something wrong, just at our meetings, we can discuss it. Because the thing I want to do is make sure that we're not fighting upstream with a bunch of people at the last minute to snugger the aspect of it. But actually, just if you want to talk, come. That's the way I'd like to see it. Is if you got discussionary points, come on out, we'll talk about it. And
get all the cards on the table. You don't want to blame for having a card up your sleeve.
If you don't want to talk to the board or come to the board, there's the members that are here, the members of your Board of Selectmen. Bring it to somebody so at least they can get it to us. Take it to Zach, and you know, get your concerns out there, because basically, and the same thing, your praises. If you think this is a good idea or think that we've done a good job or whatever, don't hesitate to tell us that too. We get the negative enough. But yeah, just come tell us what you, how you feel about it.
Any other comments from the audience? Entertain a motion.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Okay. Vote on this one.
Aye. I'm not used to getting to vote. Aye. Aye. Did I do it?